Hey everybody, I'm here with my buddy Tim. We're heading down to Corvallis for visiting the bee lab at the Oregon State University because we're going to be taking a class on dissecting bees and learning about the various viruses or diseases that can affect bees that you would usually get diagnosed in a bee lab. So we're going to be playing around with microscopes and taking a hopefully I'm going to be taking some pictures of some of the things that I'm dissecting and observing in the microscope. So if that works, we'll show up on video. Welcome to the dissecting portion of this video. On the gore scale, this video ranks some guts. If that bothers you, now would be a good time to go watch a cat video instead. Here's a honeybee. If you aren't familiar with the anatomy, I'll point out the major body parts. There are three body segments, the head, thorax, and abdomen. They have hair all over their body that serves an important function in gathering pollen. They have six legs and four wings, two on each side. Here is a front leg. This is the foot, and this part attaches to the body. The pin in this photo is pointing out the antenna cleaning feature. Here is a back leg. The foot is over here, and this part attaches to the body. In this photo, the pin is pointing to the pollen basket. When bees gather pollen, they sweep it off the hairs on their body and pack it onto their back leg. This single hair acts as the anchor point for the mound of pollen they pack onto that concave area of the leg. Here are the wings. They have two pairs like this. The larger front wing is shown upside down here. I couldn't get it to stay right side up. It kept flipping over on me, so I left it as is. But the really interesting feature I wanted to show are the hooks that are found on the smaller back wing. These hooks allow the small wing to hook onto the larger wing during flight. Now let's go over some of the features of the head. In order to do so, I'm going to need to remove it. Bees have five eyes, two large compound eyes on either side of the head, and three ocelli in the center top. They also have two antennae, but one has fallen off in this specimen. You'll notice that the antennae are located on the front of the head, right about where our nose would be, not up on top as they are often drawn by cartoonists. They have spoon-shaped jaws called mandibles that open side to side. These are perfect for chewing and shaping wax. In order to get a good look at the mouth parts, I'm going to need to pull them off. They fold up under the head. This is often referred to as the tongue, but there's much more to it than what we typically think of as a tongue. Here's an opportunity to take a closer look at the eyes. Notice how the compound eyes have hair in the facets, and right in the center top of the head, we can get a good look at one of the three ocelli. Opening the head proved to be very challenging. We were instructed to take off the cuticle. Easier said than done. It's a little like trying to peel an uncooked egg, a very small egg, with tweezers under a microscope. The reason we opened the head was to locate the hypopharyngeal gland. This is the gland that produces the primary ingredient in royal jelly. When doing nutritional analysis, this gland is removed and tested for its protein content. This is actually my second attempt at dissecting the head. I found it easier to do this underwater. Most of the debris floats off and you can see what you're doing much better. I'm still not very good at it and didn't really know exactly what I was looking at. Since everything inside the head is white, it's also easier to work over black plastic instead of the yellow beeswax in the dish we were using. The hypopharyngeal gland looks like a cluster of pearls. There was a lot inside the head, and I probably made a mess while doing this. If you're experienced at doing this, you're probably cringing while you watch my horrible attempt. Now here you can see what is mostly hypopharyngeal, all those pearls, plus some other stuff. Since my sample is not very good, let's cheat and take a look at my neighbor's sample. She did much better at isolating the hypopharyngeal gland. We also got to observe Nosema spores under the main classroom microscope, but I couldn't hook my camera up to it, so I didn't get any photos or video of that. But here's a simple field test you can do to check for a possible Nosema infection. First, take the head off the bee. This will disconnect the digestive tract from the head and make it easier to remove. Then pinch the last couple segments of the abdomen and pull the digestive tract out. You may have to hold on to the rest of the abdomen. As you pull it apart, you'll see the digestive system unfold. The bulging part of the top is the ventriculus, or midgut. If this bee had a Nosema infection, then this organ would appear whitish and swollen. It's difficult to tell the color in this photo because my white balance may be off, but this is what a swollen ventriculus looks like. Normally you should be able to make out individual rings. This photo I found online shows a good comparison. The top sample shows a normal ventriculus where you can make out the segmentation. The bottom sample is swollen. Now compare that again to my sample. This bee may have been infected with Nosema. Or I did this wrong and we're not looking at the ventriculus. That's certainly possible too. Now here's the part everyone is afraid of, the stinger. That thing is super sharp. A few people got to dissect a queen bee and observe some of her different and unique internal organs. I didn't get to, but another neighbor let me take a look at his. This egg-like structure found in the last few segments of the queen's abdomen is the spermatheca. This is the organ that stores the sperm from the drones the queen mated with during her nuptial flights. She mates with a dozen or more drones and has enough sperm to last her entire life, all stored up in this little spherical organ. In a virgin queen, this looks transparent, but is a light tan cream color in a mated queen. If you enjoy looking at these things under the microscope, I've also linked in a video from last year where I used an inexpensive handheld digital microscope to look at Varroa mites. I also put these photos up on my webpage if you want to take a closer look. The link is in the show notes. Thanks for watching!